Panel discussion. We promised to keep this under 5 hours, so we should be good. I'm very grateful for all my friends for joining us here, along with Jim and Josh. I told Jim that Bill Heichold is the only pastor I know who's as tall as he is. So they're about the same height there, I think, something like that. But for those of you who don't know them, this is Matt Saloria. He's the senior pastor at Bethel Baptist Church. This is Joe Cantu. He's the senior pastor at Cornerstone Chapel. Jim Bailey, you all know here at our church, has run Cloud Haven for years and teaching elder in our denomination. Pastor Bill Heidhold is senior pastor across the street over at the Trinity Missouri Synod Lutheran Church. And then you all know Josh and Jim. So let me open us in a word of prayer, and then I've got a few questions to prime the pump, and then y'all are going to have to take it after that, okay? So let's pray. Our Father, we thank you that you have sent your Spirit to us in your word and through your word, and we confess that we do not know exactly how you use your word in our lives, but we know that you do, and we pray that our time this afternoon would be edifying and glorifying to Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. So let me get prime the pump here with this first question. How does, of course, you know the title of this panel is The One Anothering of Scripture. How does Scripture work in one anothering? How does Scripture transform us corporately? So my first question is, how does Scripture function corporately? In our culture, we often think of the Bible in terms of individual reading, which is great, individual memorization, as we've heard Josh speak to us in the last session. And we often overlook, I think, the corporate aspects of how Scripture works in preaching and in fellowship. So would any of you like to share your thoughts about how Scripture works in the body of Christ? Corporately.
Sure.
Okay, Matt.
Go ahead. So, one definition we could use of unity is agreement. And where the Word of God says when two brothers cannot walk together unless they are agreed. And so, for the church to have unity, there must be agreement. And as a Southern Baptist, I tell our church, if you have 100 Southern Baptists, you got 100 opinions. And that's kind of how it can be. So having the Word of God as the authority for the church, it allows us to have agreement. If there is no standard, if there is nothing objective outside of us that is authority, then I become the authority, then fellowship begins and ends when I'm willing to go along. So instead of having the Word of God where we submit to it, so I believe that that's one ways it works within the church, is by building unity where we can all agree, like Euodia and Syntyche. Paul said, tell them or encourage them to agree in the Lord. Not to agree where they disagree. There's going to be disagreements. There are going to be differences. Differences do not have to be disunity when we can agree on Christ and agree on the Word of God. And so corporately is vital, or else there can't be any unity.
The scripture says that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And the Word became flesh, verse 14 in John chapter 1. You know, what unites us is Jesus himself, the Word. And as you read the Word, the Holy Spirit is our teacher, our guide. He's the one that reveals us. And like Brother Matt was saying, we don't have to agree about everything. But one thing we do agree is that we love each other. And that's how they know that we are his disciples, that we care about, you know. And we might disagree about, you know, minor details, but one thing we don't disagree with is that Jesus is the only way, the truth, and the life. And no one can come to the Father except through him. Jesus said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. And so we need Jesus. And as we abide in him, as we draw closer to Jesus, then we are able to love one another the way we're supposed to and be united in the work that he's called us to do.
Thank
Well, it's often struck me that virtually all the promises of Scripture are corporate in nature. They're made to the church. Very few of them are made to individuals, and my name's not in the Bible anywhere that I'm aware of. So just by the very nature of how Christ dealt with his disciples, how the Holy Spirit, the word of the Holy Spirit is directed toward groups of believers, tends to unite us and draw us together. So whenever we hear the scripture, we hear those promises, we're reminded that we're meant to receive those as the church, and that implies a lot of togetherness that we might otherwise miss.
A lot of times we think about the overall people of God, we think of them as a family. As a Lutheran, we'd say we're baptized, we're made part of his family. He brings us in to his family by doing the work of baptism, by adopting us, by giving the Holy Spirit to make us part of that family. And so as we think of a family, anybody ever have a disagreement with their brothers or sisters or cousins? And some of you probably seen some knockout, dragout fights too, huh? Does that stop them from being a family? No. And so we do have disagreements with different denominations, different other Christians out there. And yet, how do we deal with that? We know what? That God has done his work in them and me, and that we're all sinners. And do we sin daily? Do we sin much? Yeah, we do. But yet, what do? We can see ourselves as a family. Even though we have disagreements, we have different ways we're going to live our lives as in Christ, there's going to be things out there that people are going to look at, they're going to say, well, that doesn't really seem like that's really a Christian thing. Because what a lot of people out there that aren't Christians, what do they think Christians are?
Hypocrites.
Hypocrites. And they should be what?
Perfect.
Guess what? They got part of it wrong. The other part's right. But yet we have to deal with that as a family. So that's why I see really that unity or that togetherness we have with other Christians is, you know, we're part of a family. Yes, we have our disagreements, that sort of thing. We get, we can always look to the Lord and what he's done for us and trust in that.
Amen.
The thing that comes to mind is the way that the scriptures are infused in the songs that we sing together in corporate worship. So sing songs, hymns, and spiritual songs to one another. We do that together in the way that the word. I have a friend who attends a church, and all they do is sing the psalms. It's a one of those churches that just open up to a psalm and sing from the word right there. But whether that's your tradition or modern worship, where all of our worship is infused by scripture. And corporately, there's some power when we are singing together.
When I teach in my class the Ten Commandments, and I have the joy of being able to teach in high school the Ten Commandments at my private school, I say the Lord gave Ten Commandments on the two stone tablets to the nation, and then he fleshed out those Ten Commandments in the whole 613 laws that are in the Mosaic Code. I go to the New Testament, and that verse that's so powerful that says, they will know we are Christians, plural, by our love. And how is love then explained? By our one another. So as the Mosaic Code explained how to love God and love your neighbor as yourself, in the New Testament, it shows us how are they going to see us plural as Christians by our love, it is fleshed out in all of the one anothering verses. Love one another, encourage one another, strengthen one another, correct one another, exhort one another, serve one another, help one another. That's how we show our love. And we show it in families and communities, between churches, brother to brother, but we do it because the word is plural. They will know we are Christians, everybody, by our love.
Amen. Next question, and y'all can pass this around as you want, but how have you personally been encouraged? How have you personally been encouraged by the Word of God operating corporately? So in your own life, Jim talked to us this morning about your life story in Christ. What has God done in your life? Looking back on your life story, how has God used corporate scripture, whether it's through public preaching or small groups or just being encouraged by another brother or sister in Christ? How has God used corporate scripture, in that sense, to encourage you and build you up in the Lord?
Well, we can start on this end and we can go that way.
Okay. That's good.
When I was a young believer and just coming out of my time in college, wanting to get more nourishment in the Word, and this was in the early 80s, this is when I would turn on Christian radio, and I don't know what your background is with Christian radio, but there were Moody stations from Chicago, and there were other Christian stations, and if you wanted to hear what I used to call top dog preaching, Chuck Swindoll, John MacArthur, a lot of other people from different denominations, you turn on the radio, and I had a certain lunch break where I had the opportunity to listen to Chuck Smith and Chuck Swindoll back to back. I think Chuck Swindoll is EV Free and Chuck Smith is Calvary Chapel. You know, that didn't mean anything to me. I just heard these two guys opening the Bible. And they would preach and the radio stations would do their thing and putting the sermons together. And I was fed like nobody's business just by turning my radio on. This was before he was born. That really, 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 really helped me. And then, I don't know if y'all have ever heard of a lady teacher in Chattanooga, ended up being in Chattanooga. I didn't even know where Chattanooga was when I heard her. Her name was Kay Arthur. Have y'all ever heard of Kay Arthur?
Yeah.
Well, I now have known Kay Arthur for a good little while, and because her ministry to women is just almost unmatched in the last 40 years. But she put out a lot of study books and then would have people have small groups.
Inductive
Bible study. And my wife and I, at an early time in our marriage, got involved with precept upon precept Bible study. And in a small group setting with other couples going through, Shelby, you know, Kay Arthur. And that was so helpful in understanding how to study the Bible with other people, iron sharpening iron, not looking for our own interpretation, but looking for the intent of the original author, which was then backed up for me in seminary as the approach in hermeneutics to go for. What did Paul mean by this? What did John mean by this? And that was really helped, that those two ways.
Yeah. When Katie and I lived in California, the pastor of the church that we were going to at the time invited us to go to a conference. And some of you have heard of R.C. Sproul. This was the first Ligonier conference in California, and it was in Chuck Swindoll's church. And it was Chuck Swindoll, R.C. Sproul, Jim Packer, Jerry Bridges,
Jim Boyce.
Like, some of those names may resonate with you, but they were luminaries. And in my life story, I fight radical individualism that's deep in my heart and it's deep in the culture of this country. And so I was a head-oriented guy, always have been, and theology was very important to me, and all the theological distinctions among the denominations and so forth were in the forefront of my mind, those guys, and then there was us, you know, but we had it all right, but those guys all deviated. And I knew enough at that time, obviously I didn't know much, but I knew enough at that time to know that all those guys weren't on the same page theologically. If you are familiar with any of them, you may know that. But there they were down front, preaching their hearts out, laughing together, crying together, hugging each other. And it just, God just used that to say to me, this is what the church ought to be like. And yes, there are all these distinctions, but at heart, there are Christians in all those persuasions and Christians that can love Christians that aren't in those persuasions. That was just a big life lesson for me.
When I gave my life to Christ, I gave my life to Christ in a Baptist church, a Spanish-speaking Baptist church, and I didn't get to go to seminary, like some of you know. But I did get to learn a lot through radio, and that was my seminary teaching. I got to learn from Charles Stanley and Chuck Swindoll and, you know, MacArthur and all these guys. And I grew to love the Word, but I mainly experienced the corporate help of God's Word when a tragedy would happen, and I was really struggling in my life, and I would get the church body from all different churches and denominations calling me and say, Pastor, you know, the Lord gave me this scripture to give to you, or here's a word from the Lord, you know, in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 3 and 4, tells us that God is the Father of all comfort, who comforts us in all of our affliction, right? So that in the same way that the Holy Spirit comforts us, we can comfort others. And so that I experience a lot. You know, my brother was saying, we're family. And as a family, we're united and disagree. Like, I don't agree with this guy right here. But I know that he loves me.
Amen, brother.
So
I know I do.
Yeah, and that's what's wrong.
So, as you've seen the way that corporate body life works, what challenges have you seen to the Word of God operating corporately? What are some of the potential obstacles that would keep us apart within churches and even across different congregations? What are some challenges to the Word working corporately? What are some potential obstacles that we need to overcome? Jim mentioned radical individualism. I'm sure that each of you could testify that you've seen people, I don't think it's just here in New Mexico, but boy, it sure is here in New Mexico, where it's me and Jesus and nobody else, you know? I had a person in our church write me a letter that said, it's me and Jesus. I was talking about it, we're at the Lord's Supper, come to the Lord's table. I talked about 1 Corinthians 11 and the corporate nature of the sacrament. And she wrote a letter, and it was me and Jesus, and double underlined, me and Jesus. And God bless her. It's not just me and Jesus at the Lord's table. There's something corporate going on there. So what are some of the obstacles, potential obstacles that you see, and how can we overcome those?
So our church just went through and walked through a potential division over the issue of live streaming. So whenever the pandemic started 2 years ago, we didn't meet in person for about 2 months, and so we live streamed. And the pastors at our church, our concern was, what was temporary out of necessity, do we want that just to automatically become permanent? And so I preached two Sundays on why, you know, can the church be the church online? And what I mentioned to our congregation was, different churches are going to do different things, but that's irrelevant. What matters for us as a body here is, what do we believe the will of the Lord is? And we can determine that from God's word. So I spent 2 weeks preaching on the nature of the church. This brother mentioned radical individualism. Well, I remember as a kid, I would go to church Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night. And now you go to church one Sunday morning. And now there's multiple services, different styles of music. You can pick what you like. It's like a cafeteria. And so I believe, I'm just concerned that our concern with live streaming, as one example, is it's not just a question of the way you do church. We're redefining what church is, because the church is the gathering. And so what we've done is we've offered live streaming on Sunday morning for people that are shut-ins, because we have the technology for those that cannot be there physically to watch online. But and so our deacons minister to those, and we have a way for them to watch online. But we've encouraged people, if you're not going to be there on Sunday and you're going to be out of town, go to church, enjoy fellowship with people where you're at. And what I was encouraged with is that as we were navigating that, everybody had an opinion, not everybody agreed. But what I was so tremendously encouraged by was, we thought through this scripturally. It wasn't just, well, I think this. You're going to lose when you get in that discussion. It says, what does the word of God say? And so that was an obstacle. And so I believe there's always going to be things that will try to pull us apart. All these technologies like Facebook, social media is very antisocial. And so it's a tool, and the Lord we can use it. But at the same time, we've got to be very careful, because there is no substitute for being together. And I had to spend 2 weeks preaching on it, but that was an obstacle. You know, how do we navigate this when you can't meet physically? What do you do? And then once you become comfortable with doing Netflix church on Sunday morning, stay in your pajamas. Yeah. We've essentially, I believe, we're quick to make things accommodating, because the church is in the business of trying to reach people to maintain the institution, instead of reaching people to follow Christ and take up their cross. So there's an obstacle there, and I was encouraged at our church to hear the conversations. Even when people didn't agree, we were talking about scripturally, and that was just medicine for a pastor's heart to see that.
Amen.
So there is a lot of division, or I'd say division, differences that cause division. And I was remembering from my younger years a little story about this man who had a lot of ducks, and he had them separated at the white ducks, the black ducks, the gray ducks, and the multicolored ducks. And they were in this pond separated by this fence, and then there was a big storm and the water rose, and then they were all mixed in together. So I say that, you know, that in the Ukraine, the church Christians there, they don't care what denomination they are. They just know that, hey, we're getting killed and we need to stay united, and nothing else is going to matter. And I wonder, maybe the reason why the Lord allowed heavy persecution at the beginning of his church was to keep the church united. I don't know about you, but I know I jokingly say, it's true, we don't agree about everything, you know. We've got Calvinists and Arminian, and we've got charismatic and non-charismatic, you know. But at the end, the only thing that's going to keep us united is Christ and his love for one another. And a good a good dose of tribulation wouldn't hurt to kind of keep us, you know, in check.
Last Sunday in this church, we heard a sermon by a visiting pastor that emphasized the existential aspect of Christianity. You know, often you may hear head, heart, and hands, and what is the relationship between those things? And of course, the biblical model is that you first hear these things in your mind, and then there's the longest road in Christianity that goes from the head to the heart, where you actually become some of these things and you internalize them in a way that affects what you do and how you work out. And very often in churches we can get that mixed up, and we can get so focused on doing things that we forget about just being with one another. And that applies to individual counseling things. If you're meeting somebody that's going through something terrible in their life, they don't need to hear a lot of Bible verses, most likely. They've heard them all and everybody's preaching them to them. They don't need to be cheered up with some kind of meaningless chatter, but it means a lot if somebody's just there, just beside them. And if we could somehow work on understanding that relationship, it might help us corporately, that we don't get too sidetracked with knowing. That can be a dead end in our circles, or just doing things for one another, but just being children of God together.
I think sometimes the thing about the exterior, sometimes we forget about where this all starts. And so I think if we really look at the word together, then we can kind of deal with any differences we might have. Sure, we're still going to have some, but yet, as we look at what the word says and what Jesus has there for us, I think we've got to draw us closer together, not have as many problems. Because, like, I've had people too that I've tried to deal with where talking to them about church and being involved with the other people in the church, and the whole comment with the Jesus and me only attitude. Not only with the Lord's Supper, which, you know, some people maybe say we take, as the Missouri Synod Lutherans take it to extreme, where if you aren't a member of the Missouri Synod Lutheran Church, then we recommend that you don't take it at our churches, for the very fact that if you don't understand exactly what's going on there, what we believe the Bible says is going on there, then we don't want to go to that passage where it talks about taking it to your damnation even, or to your ill health, because the Bible talks about that. And so we do take it to that extreme. But we want people to know about that before we get to that point. And so I think a lot of that is, even with our members sometimes, maybe they aren't in the Word that they should, like they should be. They give opportunities to be in the Word daily with devotions, that sort of thing. We have all sorts of Bible studies throughout the week, on Sundays, but there's some, like you probably all know, you don't see them there. You might see them in the church, you know, at the service, but not the other places. I think the closer we get to looking into the Word with our fellow believers, the better off we're going to be.
We all, Dad shared, and I got to share this morning, we all have, if I understand your question right, Shelby, and the things that come to mind are, we all have these personal experiences that build core convictions in our own lives, which can lead to Jesus and me, this is what I think. And we're so doggone poor at listening to one another. And I'm chief among them. But as someone else is talking, and I'm face to face with that person, if all I can think is in my heart, but, here's the way that you're wrong about what you're saying, that seems to me a barrier. And I've got a guy in my church who's just a phenomenal listener. And he'll bring up something that you said to him 3 weeks ago in a later conversation, and it creates unity. It creates a bond. Even if we don't think exactly alike on a particular issue, he listened to me.
And your question, again, as I guess I'm the last guy to talk, as the mic went down, is about obstacles. Well, you can't one another without being with one another. I like to make things fairly simple, and that is very simple to me. And we've gone through this highly unusual time in the last 2.5 years with the COVID. And it has brought a worldwide disruption. But the 3,000 plus texts that we all look at from Genesis to Revelation calls us to one another. And the church, universal, will survive COVID. We'll be disrupted, we'll be out of sorts, we'll be disjointed. Well, let's go back in church history and find other periods of time when the church was disrupted, disjointed, and the Word of God brought us back together, the body of Christ, to one another. And you can't one another without being one another, with one another. And I'll share one other story. Maybe there are a few people in this room that have. I may be the only person. I've got at least half of one. Does anybody have a church wound where you've been wounded in a church? Mm-hmm. That can be an obstacle to our one another.
Right.
I remember a moment in time which was penetrated into my heart. I was a senior at Duke University working on my Christian walk. I've been involved in the Fellowship of Christian Athletes pretty deeply, and I've been visiting different churches in the Durham area where I'm, you know, just different denominations, going to different places. And I saw a lot of discord, backbiting, infighting, denominational, you know. And I saw another, I was the president of FCA at that time, and I saw a guy who was the president of InterVarsity Christian Fellowship, who was so much further down the road in his sanctification. And I went up to him and I said, "Mark, I've just had it with the local church. It just can't get its act together. There's just too much disruption, right? I'm going parachurch organization all the way when I get out of school." And he looked at me and he said, "Well," and by the way, for any of my Baptist friends, this guy's name is Mark Dever. Mark and I were contemporaries at Duke University. He was a year behind me, and now he's a head pastor at Capitol Hill Baptist Church, right behind the Capitol of the United States of America,
right.
And has done this ministry called Nine Marks, and he does it across denominational lines in the church. But anyway, Mark looked at me and goes, "Gee, Jim, that's very interesting. There's only one problem with that." And I said, "What's wrong with that, Mark?" He goes, "It's just not biblical." And he just nailed me. He absolutely nailed me. That the local church, in conjunction with the whole body of Christ, is where God is going to reach the world.
Yep.
And you need to be committed to the local church.
Amen.
And your one anothering and your outward witness to the world. And that's why I don't care how many wounds I get. Satan can throw whatever he wants to at me in the local church. I am staying there.
Amen.
Because that's what the Bible tells me.
Amen. Well, if I may, and I'll just try to project my voice loud enough for everyone to hear. Since you talk about the importance of local church and being with one another, what are some practical ways we can do that?
What are some practical ways that we can be more intentional about being with one another within the local church? I'm thinking particularly of corporate preaching, by which I mean sitting under preaching, public preaching of the word. Small groups, individual fellowship. What are some practical ways that we ourselves and the people in our congregations, how can we encourage them to be with one another more?
Good question.
Anybody got any answers?
I'm going to make it up as I go.
Matt says guilt them.
Good one.
You know, we come to church every Sunday, and of course we, at Cornerstone, we come on Wednesdays for Bible study and for a kids club. We come to Sunday school and church service, and then as soon as the church service is over, everybody just takes off, and everybody's busy, you know. And people want me to go see them, you know, individually, and I just can't do that. It's just too much, right? So I encourage the church, and I really stress it strongly that we have a potluck once a month, second Sunday of every month, and the idea is not just to come sit with your family and eat, but it's I want you to go sit with somebody you don't know, ask questions, find out about them, so that we can better know each other and have fellowship and get to pray for one another. I don't read minds, never have. Unless somebody comes and tells me, pray for me, Pastor, because, and then you tell me that, you know. But sitting down and visiting. And I try to encourage the church to do that with one another during the week. Call one another. Pastor here was talking about the one another's. There are a lot of one another's that we can be encouraging the church to do. But as pastor, I need to set the example. So I try to call people, like I try to visit as much as I can. There are some neglected groups, like nursing homes, some of the elderly, they're sad and nobody sees them, nobody cares. So I try to go once a week to do Bible study and visit them. But I'm not the minister, I'm the equipper. And I'm not doing, I don't think, a very good job of equipping my church to do the ministry, because that's who the ministers are, the people sitting in the pews. And so pray for your pastors, because that's what we need to do. We need to get the church to become ministers and to be there for one another and share the word with one another.
Like he said. When I read my Bible, I see Christian fellowship as something that's different from what happens most Sundays in our churches. I think because of individualism and other pressures of our culture, when was the last time you asked somebody what the condition of their soul was? And what challenges did they face this week in living before Christ and living the difference between how we live and the picture that's painted for us in the scriptures? And I just wonder if our interactions were less worldly, if I could use that term, than they are, just because the culture comes in the back door of the church and here it is, and it's in our midst, and that's the way we react with one another offhand. If we were to react with one another more in line with the picture that we see in Scripture, deeper relationships that would make us want to be in each other's company more often than we are.
I have a pastor friend in Denver who's an Indian man from born and raised in India, leads a congregation there. It's a young, growing, thriving, a lot of young, it's the hip place to be in Denver. But I was in a pastor's training day with him, and there were about 8 of us in there, and the topic came up about community groups, small groups. And the guy I was working for at the time was pontificating about the importance of small groups, going on and on and on about community gatherings and structure, how to structure them, how to do them in the church. This Indian guy, his name is Narup Alphonse, sitting back the whole time he's talking, he's sitting back in the corner and shaking his head. And when he gets done, Narup speaks up. He says, "You guys just don't get it, do you? You American pastors just don't get it." And he said, "You have small groups this, you got a structure." He said, in India, we call them friends. Mm-hmm. Just make friends with people. Something happens, you're not going to call the leader your small group unless he's a friend. And that was impactful for me. I tend to be a simple-minded type of person, but that was impactful in a room full of pastors. Just teach your people how to make friends with people.
Amen. Yeah. Well, I'll share, this is my motorcycle right now, I'll share two stories. First off, I want to say thank you, gentlemen, for being here from different church backgrounds and demonstrating brotherhood on this stage as leaders. That is tremendous. And my two examples of how do we bridge these gaps and build community are kind of born from that. I've had two experiences at two different churches where I was involved with other pastors, just like we are right now, in getting together and praying with one another. And we started there. We wanted to demonstrate to our various congregations that we as church leaders would get together and serve one another and pray with one another. So the time in Chattanooga, Shelby, I got together with other pastors. And by the way, it was across racial lines too. And this was in the mid-90s.
In the South.
And we were really thankful to break those racial barriers. And out of that praying together for a couple of years, the Lord bore a ministry. And that ministry was, we had a music festival. We still do have a music festival in Chattanooga called Riverbend. And at Riverbend, and Chattanooga is pretty large. It has about 400,000 people around it. And it accesses other small towns around from Tennessee. And Riverbend was a music festival every summer in early June that runs for about 9 days, and you buy a pin and you can go every night. It's on outdoors, and it's a big bend in the river right there in Chattanooga. And a great band, a highlight band, might draw 100,000 people. A lesser band might draw 60 or 70. That's how big River Bend is. And the River Bend people heard about our Pastoral Prayer Association and came to us and said, you know, we have an off night during River Bend. For a long time they had an off night where they didn't have anything. Would y'all be willing to help us put together a Christian music night for River Bend? So in between all the crazy music you could ever want to hear, they wanted to have to fill that one night with Christian music. So the here we were, interdenominationally driven. We had an opportunity to reach with the gospel the entire city of Chattanooga.
Amen.
And So we helped do it, and the first time we thought, we talked to the coordinators, we thought we were hoping for 20,000 people. And they even let us sell a separate armband just for that night. So you could spend $10 just to go to Christian night, where you had to spend like $60 to get the pin for the whole time. We had 85,000 people for the first night. And it's every Riverbend since then, there's been a Christian night. And they always draw either the third or second biggest audience behind, you know, the Rolling Stones or whatever. But that's what, when the leadership does things, what can happen. Now, my second story is not anywhere close to that, but it's the same. I go to pastor in Dalton, Georgia, and I'm hungry for fellowship. And I make friends. That's my son. I make friends with other pastors, like you guys are. And I said, let's get together and pray with one another and have a meal every other month. And we did that for about 5 years. And there were about 8 of us. And during that time, the 8 of us were able to minister to one another and share from our pulpits what we were doing together, which spurred them to together. And we got a chance to love one of the 8 of us when he retired, and going through the emotional process of that. One who got a call to South Georgia and helped him transition. One who had to take his church out of one denomination into another, and we helped him do that. And one who committed suicide. And we loved each other through that. So when the leadership does it, the congregations will follow. That's Amen. My conviction.
Amen. Yeah, please do.
Just to add to that, you know, one of the requirements for an elder is that he's hospitable. And so I think it's very important for Christians to open up their home. And so some of the sweetest times of fellowship my family's enjoyed in ministry has been having people in our home or being in people's home. So like a brother here, and I, we'll sometimes get together every week, we used to, and talk about our sermons. And we didn't go to a restaurant, lots of times we just go to each other's homes. Sometimes we get together and just our families and things like that. So doing that, I think, is really important, because if the only time we're around one another is in church, I don't know about y'all, but Sunday morning I'm so busy, I don't have any attention span to really develop any relationships. And so having people in our home, we try to do that. We've not had everybody in our church in our home, but we try to regularly have people in our home. And the Word of God tells us to do that. It's not just in the qualifications for an elder, it's a command for all the church to practice hospitality. And so I think we miss that when we're not willing to open our homes. Just having people in your home is a very great way to build friendships and to practice, you know, we want to be hospitable. How do you practice it? Well, you try to be a gracious host.
Amen. Well, I'll be the first to say that I always got more out of those conversations with Matt than he did, listening to his sermon prep.
No, he's been setting you straight.
Not at all. I'd like to go, so I went out of questions that I wrote down here, but I'd like to go off book for just a second. And I'd like to bring in two other topics that I think could be useful here when we talk about community and fellowship. And I'd like, this morning we've heard Jim talk to us a little bit about evangelism and how we, as he's quoted in 1 Peter, how do we speak of the hope, be ready to defend the hope that it lies within us with gentleness and respect. How does community, fellowship, and using the word with one another, how does that influence our evangelism? How can that be used for evangelism? Any thoughts on that? Is there a connection between community and evangelism? I'll tell you what I think there is, but we're not here to hear what I think.
I'd like to hear what you think.
Okay, well, I'll just tell you, I'll quote, because I have no original ideas. I'll quote a book, all right? And we had a small group that went through this book just as COVID hit. And so the whole point of the book was to use community in evangelism. And we couldn't do community because of COVID. And then the people who were in the small group got sent away with the Air Force. But the whole point of the book was that the New Testament envisions just what Josh said, friends and families, fellowshipping with one another. And think about it, what do we do when we share Christ with someone? We don't just leave them on the sidewalk. You know, you prayed a prayer now, hope things work out for you. What do? You bring them into the body of Christ. You bring them into the community of Jesus. Can I get an amen on that?
Amen.
I mean, how does God use that? God uses community in the gospel. Now, I'll just make one other opinion. I'll just give you an opinion. I think you all agree with it. We may not agree on exactly how the sacraments work or exactly what goes on with baptism and the Lord's Supper. I was only half kidding when I was telling Jim earlier. Even John Calvin didn't exactly know exactly how everything exactly went with the sacraments. But whatever we believe about the sacraments, we all agree you can't do the sacraments by yourself. Baptism is a corporate thing, and it brings us into the body of Christ. And the Lord's Supper is a corporate thing. It's not just me and Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
Amen to that.
I've used your story in my pulpit.
Oh, what story is that?
About the lady.
He just mentioned one time a person that had said, the Lord's Supper is just me and Jesus. And so I shared that on a Sunday morning about his experience. Yeah. I don't think I mentioned which church.
Well, I'll just say this, and then I want to hear y'all's thoughts on this. But this book talked all about committing to fellowship in homes over meals, okay? And looked at Acts chapter 2, and I'm sure you all know, John Murray points this out, that Luke uses two different verbs for breaking bread in Acts chapter 2. One, he believed, and I agree with him because he's John Murray. One is the Lord's, what we call the Lord's Supper or the Eucharist or communion, whatever your word for it is. And then the other one was what we would call potluck and sharing meals together, right?
That's a Baptist word.
That's right. My friend back in South Carolina used to call chicken the gospel bird. And so committing to get together and intentionally to use that to bring in and invite people who don't know Christ into that group to a meal, because we're all human beings. We all need food, and we all sit around this table, and it would give us ways to talk about the gospel in that. It was intentionally evangelistic to sit around the table and say, hey, I know you don't profess faith in Christ, but let's talk about, and then it'd give you, you know, a different topic for each week. And the whole book was designed to go through and have the group. It's like a manual. Like this week, we'd like you to talk about this topic, about Christ, this topic with the gospel, this topic with the Holy Spirit, and invite conversation from the non-believers you've brought to your home. And I'm telling you, and y'all know the Wilsons. It was the Wilsons, and the Wilsons would bring in people to their home that they knew around town, and he knew from the Air Force, and he'd bring his Air Force friends in who didn't know Christ, and they would talk about the gospel. And he'd say, hey, you want to come to my house? I'll feed you food. We'll talk about Jesus. And his friends would come. Now, there's some evangelism. So what do y'all think? What do y'all think about the relationship between community and evangelism?
Just one experience. My very first church was a church plant that I was able to pastor. And we would play, some of y'all may not play video games, but there was a game called Guitar Hero. And so we would have people in our home four nights a week playing Guitar Hero and just spending time doing things together. And we had a girl that was babysitter for our kids, and started dating a guy, and they came into our church. He was our sound man, not a believer, but I was able to share the gospel with him. And he said, well, I understand God, I still understand Jesus, why I need Jesus. And so, good brother as a friend, but not a brother in Christ. But we were able to share the gospel, and he genuinely was my friend, even though we weren't fellow believers. But I don't think we would have been able to have that opportunity if it was just come to church, and that's the only interaction we're going to have. So we kind of built our church playing Guitar Hero as a silly example.
That's cool. That's great. Yeah.
Very good, brother. That's encouraging. So for those of you who don't know, I pastor Cornerstone Chapel, but I also manage the Twice the Ice vending machines. There's two of them here in town. And I call it the Ice House Ministry, and I meet a lot of people all the time. And every time I go there, I get a chance to share Christ with people. And this is what Christ has called us to do, to go out, not to wait and have them come in, because they're not coming in. We have to go get them. And so the hardest thing for me was to get that sunk into my head and my heart, that we are called to go out. My father-in-law was an evangelist missionary to Argentina, helped start many, many churches. If it spoke, he witnessed to it. So, and my wife is that way. I don't care where we are, grocery store, or getting home, here's a track, you know, raising one. So I try to do that now and not be, so I asked the Lord, nothing's changed, I'm still scared of death. And I was like, I don't want to talk to this person, but we asked the Lord, you know, help me, because I don't want to. Once you get started, then I know some of you guys, he's just, I should change your name to Babylon, because you babble on and on. But just like we babble on and on here, we need to do that out there and just talk to people. Make friends, like we were encouraged to do. As we make friends, we talk to people, we ask the Lord for help, and he opens the doors to witness. And so sharing Christ is my passion now. And just so you know, I'm around town all the time, and every time I pass by your church, you know, I say, Lord, please, bless Brother Bill, help the Lord in his ministry. You know, bless what you. I'm just kidding. Bless Brother Shelby, you know, and Brother Matt. So Lord, I pray every time I go by Bethel. You know, we need to pray for one another, and we need to be there to help one another. And people that I meet sometimes, you know, I know they probably wouldn't come to Cornerstone. So I say, hey, well, you know, Bethel Baptist, or here's, you know, Brother Shelby Moon, or here at Westminster. I'm not trying to build the Cornerstone Chapel kingdom here. This is God's kingdom. Mm-hmm. And so we need to work as a community and help one another.
Well, most of you know that we had a ministry for 15 years up on the mountain, which was essentially opening our home to other people. It was, we figured out early on that the maximum number of people that we could handle at one time was 14. And we had beds for them. It's a big Brambling place. But what really dictated that was the number of people we could fit around one table. And by pushing a couple of tables together in our dining room. And the value, as Shelby mentioned in passing, of having meals together. God does something in the context of having meals together, breaking bread together. He shows up. And very often, our ministry was mostly trying to get out of the way so God could do his thing with people up on the mountain, and we would be serving and doing all this stuff, but we'd be listening in, and it was just amazing how often the conversation would turn from just frivolities to something that had to do with people's hearts and their belief in the Lord and their walk as Christians and their struggles, and God just did that. We didn't do it. And we could see him working in hearts, and he built up relationships not only with us, but among the people that came and things of that sort for in very deep and lasting ways. And I think a lot of that was just having a meal together. We did 3 sit-down candlelight meals a day. Katie did. It was, you know, we look back at it now and we said, how did we ever do that? Can't even imagine how we did that, you know, for days for groups like that, and we just don't have the stamina anymore. But that's one thing, just breaking bread together and being around a table and a meal together. God uses that situation. The other thing that stuck with me that's more of an individual thing was something that Francis Schaeffer said. He was, most of you know, God got a hold of me at Lavrie in Switzerland under Schaeffer's ministry and others that were there. Was honest answers for honest questions, which is an interesting formulation because it implies there are dishonest questions. And you guys know what those look like. If somebody's just trying to play stump the pastor with you, it's a theological rabbit trail, or maybe something that's really significant, but they're just bringing up the cultural objections to scripture and just pronouncing them as a fact, and how do you deal with that, and so forth. The question is, what difference does this make to you? Does it make any difference how I answer that? Or are you just trying to ask me something I can't answer? Plenty of those. But that was another aspect of our ministry on the mountain that was significant. And just a third thing, if it's okay. the idea of just beauty. When we started that ministry, we wanted to do it in an isolated place where general revelation was kind of screaming at you from all sides, which is what it's like up on the mountain, and bringing beauty into the home that Katie was exceptional at doing. It was a home atmosphere. It wasn't institutional at all. And the feeling that people had and what we were trying to do was open our home to people and give them a taste of the Lord through just aspects of beauty in nature and in our house. And that, I think, God used for a lot of people that had an influence on them.
I talked too much.
That's okay. Yeah, got a pastor, Greg Finke, he's got a book joining Jesus on his mission. Because what's Jesus' mission? He went to go to the cross for, to save all people, right? And so in our lives, we go about our lives with our neighborhood, where we maybe live and that sort of thing, and there's all sorts of different people from different backgrounds, and these days, you don't have to look too far before you find a non-Christian, right? Mm-hmm. I always tell people, when I was growing up, I lived in a small town in Nebraska, and I could count on one hand all the number of kids in my class that didn't belong to a church. Mm-hmm. I think there's less than 5 out of 80. You know? Now, what are classrooms like? Probably flipped.
Yeah.
And so that people just want to see what a Christian really is, and to do that in your neighborhood with your maybe the people around you and that sort of thing, over food. Maybe you have a little barbecue or something, neighborhood barbecue or a block party or those type of things where they get to know you, or you see them out doing something or whatever. And what he really stresses is let Jesus do his job of triggering something in you that you go up to your neighbor or do those sorts of things that will deal with your neighbor to find out who they are, to make friends, like we talked about earlier. Because it's his mission. For some reason, he chooses us sinners to go along with him. I don't know why. He could do a whole lot better than we ever could. But yet, what does he do? He works through us. And when he works through us, what does that give us when we bring God's word to them? Not only just with words, but with actions. And you see that spark light up in that person. What does that do for you? You do the next meal, right?
Yeah, that's right.
I mean, he is, as you know, I mean, he's your Savior. Well, but I mean, he is so in tune with who you are because he made you, that he'll put those things in there, your life, that really make a difference, that's going to change not only you, but the person around you, and give you the opportunity. And so I think just using that opportunity to make the friends, to deal with that person where they're at. And as you know, as a Christian, I always tell people, I say, when people, you know, kind of think of being a pastor, you know, they get to know that you're a pastor finally, and it's like, okay, you're a lot, you know, they're thinking in their mind that you're a lot better than they are. And when you come back, but the whole thing is that the other person, even though they're not a Christian, are better than I am, because as a Christian, I should know better. Mm-hmm. And what does that mean to them to, well, first it takes them aback, but then what does it mean to them to see that you're a real person, that you really believe what you're saying? They've had so many people give lie to them through the devil working in other people's lives with lies that they don't, sometimes they don't know what to trust. And so when you really come back to be a real person, a friend, that sort of thing, then what a better witness can you be for Christ at those situations?
Pastor Kapuko, we have something in common. You own vending machines, you said.
I manage
them. You manage them.
Yeah, yeah.
My wife and I manage a snack bar in the summers at a local pool.
There you go.
And on a staff of seven, we hire the younger siblings of the lifeguards at the pool. So my motto is, I hire underage workers and pay them below minimum wage. But on a staff of about seven, we have a transgender, two Mormons, one nothing, you know.
Which is something.
Which is something. And it's the interactions that we get to have when we invite friends of ours. Some of them are church friends, other believing families in the area. And we're at the pool eating candy in front of our snack bar workers. It's not explicit evangelism. It's just living life with other Christians in front of kids who've never seen a model of what it's like for Christians to live in front of them. And it gives us opportunity after opportunity after opportunity.
I will add nothing.
Let me ask if anyone in the audience has any questions that you think would be edifying to discuss. Brad.
So we heard earlier about radical individualization. Our second session was on sanctification, and this is on one another. What, if any, correlation is there between the one anothering in Scripture and individual sanctification, in your opinion?
That's a good question.
Recently, I've been reading about the Trinity as part of my school, and we'll be preaching on the Trinity next month. And one really tremendous takeaway that was like a light bulb for me is, you know, the Word of God says God is love. And what does that mean for God to be love, or for God to be described as a God of love? And if you don't believe in the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, then there's a solitary God. There's no community within the Trinity. That God isn't who he is until he makes us. You know, he's needing something. Because there, how can God be love if there's no object to love? Mm-hmm. So the Father has always loved the Son, and the Spirit is that bond of love between the Father and the Son, is how most Western theologians have understood. But so in our sanctification, the Word of God says that we are to be like him. And to be in the image of God is to love. That's why God said it's not good for the man to be alone. You know, we're not to be solitary. We are to be community-oriented individuals who are loving one another, which is not necessarily the way it is with the Trinity. They're not individuals. But that love, that community of love that we do see within the persons of the Trinity, is necessary for all of human life. We can't be a solitary human being. And so when we sin, instead of us being like God, who is a God who loves, we turn inward, and we are more like an image of Satan than the image of God when we're inward focused and self-love. That's why the first two commandments are love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. If we're going to be like God, we've got to love others. And sin is isolating. Sin is in darkness. Sin is private oftentimes. And it's self-loving to the exclusion of loving others. So in our sanctification, I think about this frequently. God has called me to love and shepherd the flock that is among me. I can't do that to some hypothetical church. I have to love those people. Right. Sometimes those knuckleheads, you know, they have to love this knucklehead pastor. So when we think about sanctification, you know, church hurts. Everybody probably has had them. But we've got to realize it's not about me. Sanctification is becoming like God. And for God, he loves us while we were still sinners. How can I be like God if when somebody offends me, I cut them off? And so sanctification requires relationships that are loving, sacrificial, that promote others, and not just like Philippians, where you look only to your own interests, but you look towards the interests of others. So my sanctification and my ministry cannot be solitary. Pastoring would be an easy thing if I spent all my time in the library, but I do need to spend time studying, but that is in order to feed others. It's to minister to others. And so sanctification can't happen apart from other people. Because the aim of our charge is love. And love isn't just directed at me. It's directed at the Lord and directed at others. And faith working through love, well, that love has to have an object. So there is no sanctification without one another.
I told you he was a good preacher.
So I think this is important. This is something that was really hit home for me, is that, and I asked this question a couple of Sundays ago to our congregation in Sunday school. How many sins do you have to commit before you become a sinner? Zero. You're born a sinner. You're born with a sinful nature. And I compared it to, if you see a brand new car, how many times do you have to drive it before it becomes a car? It's a car. Well, once you come to Christ, how many good deeds do you have to perform before you become righteous? Zero. He imputes his righteousness in us. It's who we are. So I focus in on getting closer to the Lord Jesus. And if my relationship with God is correct, then my relationship with you guys will be right. So the love is going to be determined by how much time I spend with God and his word. And that's how you're going to be. So sometimes what we try to do, and this is a big mistake for a lot of people I know, is that they try to become good by doing things. You have a food pantry, we have clothes closet, we do this, do that, and you become a human doing instead of being a human being. You need to be a human being with a good relationship with God instead of trying to be good by doing. So once you establish your relationship with him, then everything else will fall into place. I want to recommend a book to you, Victory Over the Darkness by Neil Anderson. It's really helped me a lot concerning that.
Yeah, I think a lot of times some people might think of sanctification as what you do, but really it's being made righteous. It's not what doing righteousness or becoming righteous. You're made righteous, and how can you be made righteous? It's through Christ, the way he did for you.
Amen.
That's the only way we can become righteous. And so as you said, we are who we are. We're made that way, and so that we live out that who we are. We have the old Adam still hanging around doing his thing, but yet we are righteous, and we leave it up to the Lord to help people to see that we are righteous, and not that we're a word above them, but that they too want something that we have. And just that peace we have that passes all understanding.
Amen.
Amen. Because nobody understands how you can have peace in the midst of turmoil. And yet, I just don't remember our district president asking me about my son who was in Iraq and during the war going on over there. And he's wondering, you know, are you all worried? worried about him. I says, well, not really, because that's the Lord's job. I can't do anything about it. He's got to watch over him while he's there, because I can't follow him around with my own gun protecting him, that sort of thing. The Lord has to do that sort of thing. So just leave it in the hands of the Lord, and people see that. There's something different about you when you live that kind of a life, even in the midst of turmoil. And when you visit with them, you don't necessarily have all the answers. There are answers that they want, because the Lord hasn't given you those answers. And yet to see that person change, even though you don't have the answers, trusting in the Lord and saying those prayers to the Lord on their behalf and that sort of thing, it grows on them. And they'll come to found, because the Holy Spirit's going to be working on them when you can't.
And Bill,
yeah.
Wasn't it Martin Luther who used the term alien righteousness?
Right.
It's not me. It's a totally foreign.
Yep.
Righteousness imputed.
Amen.
Alien righteousness.
Yeah, I don't have the words for it necessarily, but there's some, seems to me, some connection between the forgiveness we experience in community and our own sanctification. The forgiving each other, forgiving one another just as in Christ God forgave us. Because in a church this small, you all know each other really, really well. And all the uglies, you beat each other up a lot. But then experiencing forgiveness together, and somehow that affects our own sanctification.
I think, the Lord doesn't have any grandchildren. When we come to faith in Christ, we're called children of God. And He, as I loved each one of my children individually, working with them individually, I know that we grew as a family a lot more, even though we had an individual relationship when we were together. So I think sanctification is a work in the body of Christ, that God uses the body of Christ to help the individual grow into maturity in faith. And I don't think you can separate the two. The individual part is there, as I fathered my son and my daughters, but then the family, iron sharpened iron, and it just goes together. So if you want to slow your sanctification process down, go experience God in the woods on Sunday mornings all by yourself.
Amen. Other questions? Bobby Cover.
Some of you people know that some Our Ladies are doing gentle and lowly study. And Dane Ortland makes a point of balancing the wrath of God with the love of God, that the two are the whole understanding. But it's easy to misunderstand when you're an outsider saying God's always mad at me, and yes, He's angry at the sin that is in you or that needs to be taken out. He's angry at the enemy of our souls, and so that whole aspect of anger. How do you do that? How do you balance that in sanctification and in reaching out to people who don't know the gospel?
I would appeal to my 10th grade biblical ethics class that I teach. And a lot of that teaching of that class is discovering the God of the Bible, not the God that this person thinks is God, or this person thinks is God, but the God of the Bible. And I use an illustration, and that illustration in the class helps my Muslim and my Hindu and my unchurched and my churched and my, all this. They get it when I talk about the God of the Bible this way. And I say this to these 16-year-olds. I said, one day you are going to hopefully present a diamond ring to a pretty girl and ask her to marry you. And she's going to look at that ring, and when she looks at it, it's going to sparkle. And she's going to love the sparkle of that ring. And it sparkles because it's been cut into different facets. And the light hits all those facets and makes it sparkle. That's the God of the Bible. He has wrath, long-suffering, love, holiness. All of his different character qualities all work together to show him as Almighty God. And that's the God we present as believers to a world that needs to know him. The God of the world, the God the world makes up, only has one facet. Either wrath, God is mad, or he's only love. How could a God of love do that? But when you show God with all of his facets, then the world makes sense. And that God is very attractive because he, in all of his facets, deals with all of the issues of humanity. Does that make sense?
Yes.
And a 16-year-old can understand a ring illustration.
I don't know if you heard it, but the book they're studying is Gentle and Lowly by Dane Orland. If you haven't come across that yet, I highly recommend it to you. But a very telling question among Christians who suffer from this same dysphoria of the image of God is, how do you picture God in heaven? Is he like this? Oh, come on, Jim, there you did that same thing you said you'd never do it again. There you are, and yeah, I love you, but, you know, it's kind of, we should do better, and so, or do you picture him like this? Is he grinning? Is he smiling? Is he looking at you as a father would look at a loving son, expressing his love for a son? Our problem is we don't really believe we're sons and daughters of the King of the universe, that nothing can separate us from his love. Nothing we do, we can't make him love us more, we can't make him love us less. He's we're free and we're sons of the King. How would we act if we really believed that?
Amen. That's good stuff. Y'all need to say amen when he says it.
Just to encourage you, if you've ever read anything by R.C. Sproul, I just read a book of his. It's The Holiness of God, probably his greatest book. Read it with a group of men. There's one chapter where he talks about how the love of God and the wrath of God, how do those relate to one another? Sometimes we think about those things as like two modes, like God, he shifts into love mode, and then he shifts into wrath mode. And so the chapter is talking about how God's wrath is his love responding to injustice. Like if somebody does something to my daughter, you're going to see how a loving father can become very angry, right? They're not opposite things. It's how love operates to evil and injustice. And so a really great chapter that stuck out from the book was how we try to divide God's attributes. Like yes, God has all these facets, but all the attributes of God are in one God.
Right.
He's not his wrath and his love and his holiness and his patience and all these are not, they're not opposite ends of their God is full of his attributes, and these things don't contradict one another. He's always perfect. And so a really good chapter by Sproul, he said it in the Sproul way that only he could. It was very helpful because sometimes we do try to separate God's love and his wrath like they're opposite things, and they're not.
That's good. We probably have time for one more question, and then we need to wrap up. Dawn is giving me the signal. Okay, let's see. If there's one more question, we can do that probably, and then we should wrap up. Katie, you get the last one.
Actually, it's not a question. I just wanted to reiterate what all of you have said, because our Women's Bible Study is a group from the Mountain, from the Church of the Epiphany, and members here. We're friends now. We're transparent with one another. It is a lovely, lovely time of us being together. And I think we we've loved others out of the love that we have within that group. And you can sense it when we talk about it. It's what happens when we do love Jesus and know about him and love one another.
Amen.
It's wonderful.
Amen. Jim?
I have to go to the bathroom.
Could I be excused? My brain is full.
Yeah.
You getting all
that? That's a far side, Dr.
Yeah. No, that's right.
You're getting all this?
Yeah, right. Okay. Let me close us in prayer, and then I would ask you to join me in thanking our brothers up here. Lord, we thank you. We thank you that you have, as Isaiah said, bowed the heavens and come down, and that you've taken on flesh, that you in Christ have united the divine nature with the human nature of your creation. What an amazing thought that is. As Matt was saying earlier, what an amazing thing that we will never fully, we trust, understand exactly how the Trinity exists. We don't. Our minds can't fully understand it. And just like Paul said, we've been made stewards of the mysteries of God. There are many things that are still mysteries to us. And we trust that one day we will know all the things that we need to know. And the things that we don't need to know, we trust that you will keep. Lord, we thank you for our unity in Christ. We thank you for the way your word works in groups. And we do pray, Lord, as Jesus prayed, that one day we would be one, as you, our Father, and Christ are one. We pray that you would sanctify us in your truth, and we know that your word is truth. And so we look forward to a time when we will agree fully. And it may not be until we're in the presence of Christ, but we know that that will be a wonderful day. In the meantime, give us grace that the world may know we are Christians by our love. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Would you please join me in thanking these brothers for your time?